The Bee Gees were one of the most extraordinarily successful musical acts of all time. But while their music has become much loved all around the world, there is a lot that people don't understand about this hit-making group. Here are some false things people believe about the Bee Gees. The Bee Gees are one of the bigger acts to ever emerge from Australia. Immensely popular around the world during the mid-20th century, they easily measure up against other hit Australian acts of the era, such as Olivia Newton-John and Rick Springfield. But they were also huge overseas, having scored 9 number one hits in the United States, for example, and another 5 chart toppers in the United Kingdom, not far from the band's hometown. But how can the Bee Gees be from Australia and the British Isles? Well, it's because the band known as the Bee Gees only formed in Australia after the Gibb brothers moved there as children. Barry, Robin, and Maurice Gibb. Yeah, that third brother, the one whose name looks like Maurice. It's actually pronounced Morris. Anyway, they were all born in the late 1940s in Douglas, the capital of the Isle of Man, a small island off of Great Britain. While not part of the United Kingdom, the Isle of Man's residents are nonetheless British citizens. In 1958, the Gibbs all moved to Sydney, Australia. When it comes to naming your band, it's always better to keep things simple. Just ask the Bee Gees. More than 50 years ago, Barry, Robin, and Maurice Gibb decided on what turned out to be the perfect name for their little band. An easy-to-remember, easy-to-pronounce, phonetically spelled-out iteration of the letters B and G. It's so immediately recognizable that it even surpasses language barriers, grabbing potential fans who don't speak the Bee Gees' native English. You might also think it's a natural fit for the group, considering the letters B and G clearly stand for the words Brothers Gibb. But that's not why they named themselves the Bee Gees. If anything, it's more of a happy and uncanny coincidence. In fact, the moniker was derived from the names of 2 other musicians who the Gibbs had known during their early days as a group. After moving to Australia in the late 50s, the Gibb brothers got a gig playing at the Redcliffe Speedway for the track's promoter, Bill Good. Good then introduced the boys to Bill Gates, a local radio presenter, who was keen to have them play on his station. Later, during a meeting with the family, they decided to call themselves the Bee Gees, as 3 of the people present had those initials: Bill Good, Bill Gates, and Barry Gibb. The name stuck, and the Bee Gees were born. The term Bee Gees and Gibb brothers are used almost interchangeably nowadays. And yes, from the band's disco era and into the next few decades, the Bee Gees did primarily produce, write, and record as a trio. But they didn't go it alone. In fact, the band used a number of collaborators and studio musicians to nail down their sound both on stage and in the recording booth. The Bee Gees got even bigger when you go back to the group's days as a British invasion-era pop rock band. Back then, they were a 5-piece. The trio of Gibbs, assisted by 2 bandmates to whom they weren't related. On the Bee Gees' 1967 debut album, First, the credited musicians are Barry Gibb on rhythm guitar, Robin Gibb on organs, Maurice Gibb on various instruments, plus Vince Maloney on lead guitar and Colin Peterson on drums. It was only later that the core Bee Gees became strictly a family act. The Bee Gees enjoyed tremendous global success as a disco act in the late 1970s and became closely associated with the sounds, look, and sensibility of the era. And, of course, they produced the soundtrack for one of the best-known disco movies, Saturday Night Fever, which sold a staggering 25 million copies between 1977 and 1980. But disco was only one of the many strings on the Bee Gees' bow. And in the waning part of the 1970s, it was merely their latest endeavor. The group had already enjoyed a long and healthy career as hitmakers by the time disco hit. In the mid-60s, the Gibbs moved to London, hoping to cash in on the British rock craze of the era. Sounding less like the Beatles and more like a vocally accomplished, slightly psychedelic Herman's Hermits, the Bee Gees scored a number of smash hits in the late 1960s and early 1970s. In a word, the Bee Gees were weird, but it worked. And the band found considerable pre-disco success in America, with the quiet and contemplative song How Can You Mend a Broken Heart even going to number 1. While they were known for plenty of other styles of music, the Bee Gees are rightfully remembered as the most disco of all disco acts, thanks to genre-iconic songs like Stayin' Alive, You Should Be Dancing, and Night Fever. In those tunes and others, the band found a formula that truly worked: a relentless bass groove, plenty of brass and strings, and the ultra-high-pitched and powerful vocal stylings of Barry Gibb. Gibb utilized a vocal technique called falsetto, generally used by male singers to reach the upper register of the musical scale, which they wouldn't otherwise be able to hit naturally.
If I want my falsetto to happen, I have to start screaming in the shower. What are you doing in there?
Gibb used falsetto so much that he's basically become forever linked with the technique, but he certainly didn't create it, as some people think. While Gibb popularized falsetto for crossover pop and rock audiences, he and his fellow Bee Gees took inspiration from previous pop artists, who had also used falsetto in their music. In an interview with Rolling Stone, Barry Gibb singled out a few of these acts, saying, "We like the stylistics and the delphonics and the people who sang in falsetto." As such, the Bee Gees were far from the inventors of falsetto-heavy pop music. They just helped make it bigger. Disco revitalized the fame and fortune of the Bee Gees, bringing the long-established group more success than they had ever seen before. And it's hard to separate the Bee Gees' disco era with the release of Saturday Night Fever, the companion album to the blockbuster John Travolta movie, to which the Bee Gees contributed 8 songs.
People are interested in the music of yesterday, not the young people of today. And this is the first time they've seen a film about today, and they can see themselves in the film.
But this new era for the Gibb brothers didn't actually begin with the soundtrack to Saturday Night Fever. After all, it's not like Hollywood just gave the Bee Gees, a pop rock group best known for their 60s and early 70s folk hits, free rein to make a smoldering disco soundtrack album for a tentpole movie. Saturday Night Fever wasn't released until late 1977, and by this point, the Bee Gees had already started to surf the disco wave, having scored top 10 hits with their disco tunes Nights on Broadway and Jive Talkin'. As it happened, it was the group's manager, Robert Stigwood, who had agreed to finance and produce Saturday Night Fever. The Gibbs subsequently signed on to produce a number of songs for the movie and its soundtrack. In the end, their involvement was more of a favor to an old friend and associate than anything else. The Bee Gees may have caught disco fever, but they were always willing to embrace other genres of music too, which is why, contrary to popular belief, the Bee Gees remained relevant past the 70s and into the 80s. Likely knowing that the disco cash cow wouldn't last forever, the Gibbs adapted with the times. For example, soft rock would prove very popular in the early 1980s, and the Bee Gees embraced it wholeheartedly. After hitting number one in 1979 with the ballad Too Much Heaven, the group enjoyed some success in the immediate post-disco period, racking up minor and moderate hits like He's a Liar, Living Eyes, The Woman in You, and Someone Belonging to Someone. In 1980, Barry Gibb co-wrote and produced the whole of Barbra Streisand's contemporary pop breakthrough album, Guilty, and his work on the album was so significant that he's even featured on the cover. The single Woman in Love, an adult contemporary gem of a duet between Streisand and Gibb, later went to number one. Also topping the charts in 1983, Islands in the Stream, the country classic by Kenny Rogers and Dolly Parton, which was written by none other than the brothers Gibb. Sadly, the Bee Gees ended up as has-beens, reduced to the dustbin of history after the end of disco sent them scampering out of the music industry forever, right? Well, no, that's not actually what happened. Perhaps unsurprisingly, considering the Bee Gees were prolific musicians long before the dawn of disco, the group remained active in the entertainment industry until well past the death of disco, too. The Bee Gees recorded music throughout the 1980s, and at the end of the 80s, found themselves driven harder than ever by the death of their younger brother, Andy Gibb. In 1989, they landed in the top 10 for the first time in a decade with the ultra-slick, very 80s-sounding synth-pop headbobber, One. This didn't lead to a lasting Bee Gees revival, per se, but it did remind the world that those Gibb brothers sure could write a catchy song. History repeated itself 8 years later when, in 1997, the Bee Gees enjoyed another comeback hit. The keyboard and synth-wind-driven mid-tempo ballad Alone hit number 8 on the pop chart and became a smash on soft rock radio. And that was nearly 2 decades removed from the disco era. It's like the old saying goes, if it looks like a Bee Gee, sounds like a Bee Gee, and was basically inescapable on the radio in the 1970s, then it must be a Bee Gee. But this isn't quite true, especially when it comes to Andy Gibb. By the end of the 70s, the Bee Gees had such a hold on pop music that they decided to expand their reach, providing Bee Gees-esque hits for other acts, including Samantha Sang, Yvonne Elliman, and their youngest brother, Andy Gibb. The later Gibb hit number one with his first 3 singles in 1977 and 1978, I Just Wanna Be Your Everything, Love Is Thicker Than Water, and Shadow Dancing, all with a writing credit from at least one other Gibb sibling. Not yet 20 years old, Andy Gibb became one of the period's most prominent teen idols, much of which was down to the fact that he looked and sounded like a younger, blonder version of the Bee Gees themselves. And while he was indeed a member of the Gibb family and performed songs penned by his brothers, Andy was never a member of the Bee Gees. He was a solo act through and through, right up until his untimely death in 1988. Breaking up a band is a complex ordeal. There's plenty of potential for trauma and emotional disarray when close friends and collaborators decide they no longer wish to work together. Still, it does happen, and the consequences can be even more severe when the musicians in question are family. The Gibb brothers have always been the core of the Bee Gees, but while all three tried to embark on solo careers and often worked with other people, the Bee Gees never actually broke up. Anytime the Bee Gees weren't making music together were simply thought of as hiatuses or creative slumps. In the end, the only thing that could break the Gibbs' close bond was death. Morris Gibb passed away at age 53 in 2003, and surviving Bee Gees Barry and Robin Gibb occasionally played together thereafter, including at the Prince's Trust concert in London in 2006.
Nobody sings like you, so it's like...
We should get together. We should have lunch.
The Bee Gees as an entity only truly ended in 2012, after the death of Robin Gibb, leaving oldest brother Barry the only surviving member of the band.